Hi! This video is on optics, and in particular on how to make a flat optical surface. Now, generally speaking, one of the easiest ways to make a surface flat is by using abrasive action against another flat surface. For example, when you use a file or a piece of sandpaper to flatten an aluminum object. And in this respect, making a flat optical surface is not that different. The method mostly used is actually to take a flat abrasive surface and rub the object against it until it reaches the required spec. But achieving the specs required for optics is not always easy. The flatness and smoothness specs are on quite a different level when compared to general machining methods such as milling and grinding. For a good optical surface, we want the accuracy to be in the nanometer range. So the peak to valley flatness should be in the order of, let's say, 50 nanometers, which is more than 100 times better than is achieved by machining. So, how do we get a glass surface this flat? Well, in this video, I will discuss the polishing method that I use personally to achieve an acceptable result. And it's actually a modified version of the continuous pitch polisher machine, which is also known as the planetary polisher. So, let's first have a look at the working principle of this machine. Generally, continuous pitch polishers are very heavy and large, and they operate in a 24/7 continuous operation scheme. And this is because they're very labor intensive to set up. The flat surface in the machine itself consists of a circular ring of optical pitch, which is on top of a very stiff rotating carrier plate or ring. The abrasive component is often an aqueous suspension of cerium oxide or aluminum oxide, and the choice for a specific abrasive is dependent on the type of material that you would like to polish. For those of you who don't know what optical pitch is, it appears to be a black solid material and it looks a bit like tar. But even though it appears to be a solid material at room temperature, it's actually a so-called Newtonian liquid, although one with a very high viscosity. And this viscosity is strongly dependent on the temperature. As is shown in this graph, the viscosity can vary by a factor of 5 over a temperature range of only 5 degrees Celsius. A Newtonian liquid is special in the sense that it deforms linearly with the external forces acting upon it. So, if it experiences an external pressure, if only from its own weight under gravity or from surface tension, it will immediately deform. And of course, with very small forces, the deformations will be small at first, but will increase as time proceeds. So the material is actually constantly flowing, just like a liquid would, only very, very slowly because of the high viscosity at room temperature. And in a continuous pitch polisher, this principle of constant flowing is exploited. So in the machine, a ring of pitch is constantly rotated and the flatness of the pitch surface is controlled by a heavy flat disc called the bruiser plate. We want the bruiser to be as flat as possible, so it should not deform under any temperature gradients such as those caused by friction. For this reason, it's generally made of a low expansion material such as Zeiss or clear ceram or fused silica. And the bruiser plate is held at a specific position on the pitch ring, and this position can actually be varied in distance from the center of the ring. The position of the bruiser plate controls the general surface shape of the pitch, so if the bruiser is placed in a central position, where the center of mass is supported equally on both sides, the pitch ring will retain its flatness. But when it's moved more to the outside of the ring, the support surfaces for the center of mass will become unequal on either side and the pitch surface will gradually become more and more convex. And this is due to the constant flow of the pitch under the pressure of the bruiser and the fact that the flow rate is directly related to this pressure. Now, in this image, the curvature of the pitch is of course heavily exaggerated for illustration purposes. Generally, we don't want the deviation from planar to be higher than, let's say, a micron or so. Now, in a similar way, if we place the bruiser plate more to the inside of the ring, the pitch will gradually become concave. And in this way, we can control the surface shape of the pitch very accurately by varying the position of the plate in the vicinity of the equilibrium position. In the meantime, the pitch surface also performs abrasive action on all the surfaces in contact with it. So these will all gradually assume the shape opposite of that of the pitch surface. And this also includes the shape of the bruiser and, of course, numerous other objects that we can simultaneously polish flat against the same pitch surface. So, to set up the machine and to achieve an acceptable flatness for the pitch takes quite a lot of effort. But another reason why we want to run in continuous operation is that when you stop the machine, the flow of pitch will still continue under its own weight and its surface tension, but especially under the high weight of the bruiser. So if you stop the machine and leave the plate on the pitch surface, the surface will become unusable within a minute. And this is because deformation on the nanometer scale occurs very quickly. Now, for the same reason, the pitch surface will also deform overnight at this level under the forces of gravity and surface tension. So it will require some work if you stop at the end of the day and need to restart the process at a later moment. Now, there's a few things worth noticing. For example, the grooves in the pitch surface. These grooves actually serve a similar purpose as the grooves you find on a car tire. They allow for good contact between the pitch and the optical surface. Now, as I mentioned earlier, the abrasive used is an aqueous suspension with micron-sized particles, and in order to make physical contact between glass and pitch under continuous movement, the water in the suspension has to be able to quickly flow away from the contact area. Otherwise, the object will just be aquaplaning and there will be very little contact and very little abrasive action. Now, aquaplaning is also undesired because of the occasional contact at the outer edge, which locally leads to a relatively high rate of removal of material. The effects of aquaplaning can be further reduced by using a low rotation speed. Another condition required for good flatness is to use a low point of attack on the object. So if we hold the objects too high, they want to rotate under the frictional forces acting on the surface, and the local pressure at the edge will also influence flatness in a negative way. And this is the reason why objects are pushed over the surface at a point very close to the pitch surface. Now, I generally use a somewhat modified version of the continuous pitch polisher, and the reason for this is simple. I do not have sufficient work for running a machine in continuous operation. In fact, I run my machine only during the daytime. Now, in the past, I built an official continuous pitch polisher, and you can still actually find an old and very short video on my channel that shows this machine in action. And the method that I use now allows for setting up the polisher in less than an hour. And although it's not as accurate as a well-running continuous polisher, it is still very useful for making optics because 50 nanometer surface accuracy is perfectly possible. So my method is different in the sense that I use a much thinner and much harder layer of pitch than normal. In comparison, the pitch I have is about 100 times more viscous and the layer thickness is more than 2 times lower. So this reduces the amount of plastic deformation within a limited time frame by the same factors. So to set up the machine, I use a candlescent lamp of about 1000 watts. And this is only intended for heating up the actual surface of the pitch, generally to about 45 degrees Celsius in just a few seconds. Now, because the radiative energy is absorbed in the surface and the pitch is actually a very bad thermal conductor, it is possible to selectively heat the surface of the pitch. So I only make the direct contact area mullable. Next, I quickly place a heavy and very flat plate on the pitch ring and leave it there for about 15 to 20 minutes. I would have used ceradur if I had a plate of that size, but I found out that the much cheaper granite also works quite well. Now, the plate flattens the surface and at the same time absorbs the small amount of heat in the pitch surface. And during this flattening process, the plate needs to be rotated a few times to prevent it from sticking to the pitch. Now, after the plate is removed, we have a very flat and hard pitch layer. And if required, this flattening procedure can be repeated at regular intervals to reset the pitch surface. The granite is ground flat to an accuracy of about 1 micron. And at first glance, this flatness seems insufficient to polish objects to within the nanometer range. But because I generally process relatively small objects, there's actually no problem. The peak-to-valley surface flatness generally improves with the inverse square of the object size. So this flatness of 1 micron over 400 millimeters total translates to a flatness of 0.01 micron over a distance of, for example, 40 millimeters, which is 10 nanometers. As for the construction of the machine, the drive mechanism is made from a three-phase washing machine motor. Now the stator is mounted to the support frame and the rotor is attached to the round aluminum polishing table. In the center I use a large ball bearing to keep the plate in position, and on the outside the plate is supported by 5 rollerblade wheels. The rotation speed of the motor can be varied using a three-phase frequency converter. And because you can just take the table off the machine, it's very easy to clean. Also, I use a translation stage and a computer running Mach 3 software to continuously vary the position of the objects on the pitch ring. And this is to distribute the pressure on the pitch equally and to avoid local deformations. Now, if the objects to polish are somewhat heavier, it's even possible to mimic the action performed by a bruiser plate and change the surface shape by varying the average position over the pitch ring. So here's a quick example of three parts that needed to be polished flat. They were first mounted on a low expansion glass plate with a thin layer of blocking wax, and then grounded flat by using a range of silicon carbide powders. The plate, with the objects attached, was then placed on the machine and the shape of the surface was checked at regular intervals using a test glass. Now, because I cannot explain this type of interferometric testing in just a few seconds, I decided to save it for an upcoming video. When a continuous pitch polisher is operating correctly, the objects placed on it should have an angular rotation speed identical to that of the pitch lab itself. So only then you will have a constant uniform abrasion. Now, to quickly illustrate, you see that with identical angular rotation of the object and the pitch lab, the difference in translation speed between the pitch lab and the object is identical over the complete surface of the object. After the surfaces were completely polished, the objects were released from the carrier plate and then polished individually using a holding ring. And this is because the blocking wax will always introduce some strain in the objects, which is released when you unblock them, so they will slightly deform at that point. Individual polishing further improves the surface flatness and smoothness. Okay, that's it for now. If you have any questions regarding practical details of the process, don't hesitate to ask them in the comments section.